interplanar distance between them, and then you have again different planes here. You can go on drawing different planes in the crystals. So here the unit cell is the basic repeating unit, and then you have parallel planes, different parallel planes in the crystal, and these crystallographic planes are identified as the by the Miller planes. So the structure and properties also very much correlated. Suppose if you see here, carbon can be tetrahedral, or it can also form the hexagonal honeycomb type of sheets. Right? So this is, what is this structure? Graphite, and this is diamond. Right? So the material is same, but the way atoms arranged in these two materials are very different, right? So the properties of these two materials are also very, very different, isn't it? So if you take the diamond, which is one of the hardest materials, right? And graphite is very, very soft. So this is because of the difference in their arrangement of atoms. So if you have different arrangement, then the properties will be very different. Suppose if you take one material, and if you do not know the arrangement of molecules or atoms in the material, so then it will be difficult for you to actually predict the properties. Suppose if you have a material, then if you know beforehand all possible arrangements, then you should be also able to define the properties, so then you can even predict the properties. So this area is actually called crystal engineering. Okay, so if you can also change the crystal structure by introducing some functional groups, or by bringing in another molecule, okay, if you have a way to change the crystal structure, then you will have a way to change the properties. So this area is actually called crystal engineering, and that is where I do my research. So how does diffraction work? So we take the crystals, and then we pass the X-rays through the crystals, and then we see the diffraction pattern. So what is the reason for this? And so why do we actually see the diffraction from crystals, and then why we do not see the diffraction from amorphous materials? So here, so what happens is, when you pass the X-rays through any material, suppose you assume that you have just one atom. Okay? So when you pass the X-rays through this atom, so X-rays would interact, say electromagnetic wave, the X-rays would actually interact with the electrons, and then electrons start oscillating with the speed of the light. Okay? Then at some stage, then the light will be released in random direction. Okay, so then X-rays are basically electrons are oscillating around the atom in the orbitals. So then at some stage the wave would be released from the atom. So suppose if you have many electrons, and then if the atom is taking many waves, and the X-rays are scattered elastically in all the directions, so you don't see any diffraction pattern. Suppose if I take atoms and then put them periodically in a very regular arrangement, each atom would be independently doing the same. It would just take the electrons, and then electrons start oscillating at the speed of the light, and then electrons, X-rays will be going with the same wavelength in all possible directions. Right? But when you have atoms in repeated positions, so then in certain directions you can actually see constructive interference of the waves. Suppose if you have two atoms close to each other, and then you are passing the X-rays from here, and then waves are going in all the directions. Suppose if one wave is going like this, and then in another wave is going something like this, So when they come on, they basically don't converge. Okay. So suppose if two waves are added in this fashion, okay, the faces are completely opposite. So then the resultant intensity will be almost nil. Suppose if I take one wave and then if I look at the combination of these two, then basically I add them constructively. Okay, when the phases match, then the waves are added constructively, and when the waves are added with different wrong phases, then or opposite phases, then they will be added destructively. So suppose if I have a regular arrangement of the atoms, each one is diffracting the each one is actually reflecting the waves in different directions. Suppose if I pass the X-rays through here and then I look at the wave going in this direction, and for this also I look at the wave going in this direction. So if these two are going in the same in the parallel axis, okay, suppose if the waves are actually added like this in any of the direction, if the waves are added constructively, then they will be added, and then you can actually expect a diffraction peak. So then if we have infinite number of atoms in this direction, right, so you have infinite number of atoms and then you are passing the X-rays through the material, and at certain angles you will be actually constructively adding n number of waves, so that would give you the diffraction peak. So this is the scenario only at the one dimension, right? This is only at one dimension. And then suppose if I take a two dimensional sheet of atoms, then I also have atoms here, right? And then I have more atoms in the third layer, so then I have many atoms. So then the angle is same, and then the scenario would be exactly same for this layer of this row of atoms and then other row of atoms. Okay, so then that means everything is added. Then I also have atoms below, right? I also have the atoms below. So that means from the entire HKL plane, so I will actually add all these waves in the constructive way, and then I get the diffraction peak. So this is how we get the diffraction peak. And then, so this, whenever you get this diffraction peak, you call it as the Bragg condition. So I'll read it very quickly. When an X-ray beam hits an atom, the electrons around the atom start to oscillate with the same frequency as the incoming beam. Okay, then the electrons start oscillating. And then this is called the Thomson scattering. So the Thomson scattering is nothing but the inelastic scattering. So that means the wave, whichever you use as the incident wave, the same wave comes out. This is the Thomson scattering. And in this case, the electric field of the X-ray wave accelerates the electron, causing it to emit radiation at the same frequency as the incident wave, and thus the wave is scattered elastically. Okay, the wave is scattered elastically, and in almost all directions we will have destructive interference. I only talked about this particular angle, but what happens to the X-rays which are actually going in different directions? So in most of the, so when you pass the X-rays through this atom, so the X-rays are basically scattered in all directions, right? From every atom you have X-rays passing in all the possible directions, but only in certain directions you have constructive interference, and in all other directions you have destructive interference, because you are not adding the waves constructively. So there is a phase difference, you don't see the diffraction peaks in other directions.
When any atom is in the bulk, it's in the middle of something, the constructive interference is very less. The possibility of constructive interference is very less.
What do you mean by bulk?
Means in the middle of something.
No, we are asking about the repetitive atom sitting in a repetitive positions. We have just only one atom, so then you will not see any constructive interference from the other atoms. So we are. I'm not giving you the full, full picture of this. So you have to in this, you have these atoms. So you have certain distance between these. Okay, I will come to the other details later. Maybe you can ask the question later. So, however, the atoms in a crystal are arranged in a regular pattern, and in a very few directions we will have constructive interference. Only in very few directions we will have constructive interference from the atoms arranged in a repetitive fashion. The waves will be in phase, and there will be well defined X-ray beams giving the sample at various directions. So these are called the refraction peaks, which we collect on the two-dimensional detector. Hence, a diffracted beam may be described as a beam composed of a large number of scattered rays mutually reinforcing one another. So that means that when you see the diffraction pattern, that is actually coming from a number of waves which are added constructively and then scattered from the X-ray. This model is complex to handle mathematically, and in a day-to-day work, we talk about X-ray reflections from a series of parallel planes inside the crystal. Right? So, to show you schematically, so this is the incident X-ray beam, right? It hits the atom, and now we are considering the X-rays going in this direction. In principle, the waves are going in all possible directions, so we are only looking at the rays which are added constructively. So this is the X-ray beam, and then you have another X-ray beam. So these are the two parallel plane of atoms, and then this is the distance between these two planes, right? So suppose this wave is going from here to here, and another wave if you consider from the next layer, so this is going from here to here. So the length they pass through, the length of this path is actually not same, right? Suppose if I start it here and then at the same plane here, and then I am collecting them at the same plane here, okay, in another plane. So here the distance from here to here and here to here is not same, right? So there is small difference. So what is the difference? This is the difference, right? From here to here and here to here it is same. The distance is same, and this is the extra distance. So when you look at this wave and then this wave, the path difference between these two waves is actually here, right? So to have the constructive interference, so here they are in the same phase, right? Up to here, we are just passing the X-rays with the same phase, and up to here there is no problem. And when it comes here, then it changes the direction and then goes in a different direction. So here you have a path difference. Suppose by the time it comes out here, it finishes multiple integer wave numbers. Suppose if it finishes one wave number, so that means, suppose if at this point, so if it is like this, and then when it comes out, if it is coming out like that, and then so it is exactly same, right? So if it finishes one wavelength, suppose, and then when it comes out, if you have exactly the same wavelength as same phase as the first wave, first X-ray, right? So, or it could be also two. If it finishes two wave numbers, then we will have the same scenario, or it could be any number. But it has to be a full wavelength, multiple integer of the wavelength. So when it is coming out with the same phase, then there will be a constructive interference. If this path distance is not n lambda, then there will be a difference in the phase. So then you will not have the intensity. You will not add them in the constructive. So the condition, Bragg condition is The path difference between these two waves should be n lambda. When you have this, then you will have the constructive interference, and then you will see the diffraction peak. So this is for one set of plane in one direction. Suppose if I have another layer of atoms here, then if I make a two-dimensional shape, then I also should have proper distance here. Only at proper angles, then I will also have the constructive. So basically, you have three equations: one in this direction, and then another in this direction, and another in the other direction. When all these three, from all these three angles, if you have this right condition satisfying, then you will see the diffraction peak. So this is actually called Bragg's equation, and so 2D, this difference is basically 2D sin theta, and from this we try to find out the distance between the two planes. So this is what helps us to actually find out the distance between the two planes, and then this would allow us to actually finally determine the X-ray structure. So I am not going into all the details, but this one particular diffraction diagram is very, very important for the X-ray crystallography. So suppose if you see here, you have a wave which is going from this atom and then diffracted here, and then you have another wave in the same phase. When it passes through this and then comes out from this point, it has exactly the same wavelength. So then there will be a constructive interference. So this is actually the Bragg condition, and whenever you have this, then you will have the diffraction peak, and then once you have the diffraction peaks, then you use lot of mathematics and then computers, and then finally you try to find out the de-spacing between the atom, these two planes, and then you have n number of set of planes from different orientations, right? So then you find out all the de-spacing and then relative positions by solving the phase problem. Then finally you will be able to identify the electron densities, because finally what you look at here is the electron density, right? Because electrons basically diffracting the X-rays. So the position of electron density will what you actually you get from the X-ray diffraction. The once you have electron densities, then you will be able to, depending on how much electron density you find, you will be able to assign the atom. Suppose if you have carbon, then you know what is the expected electron density, right? If you have nitrogen, if you have oxygen, so then you will know atoms, and then that's how you can actually build up your whole molecular structure. So the technique basically works in the following way. You take the X-rays and then you pass through the crystal, and then when you have Bragg condition satisfied, then you will see the diffraction spots, and then from that you analyze, take all the diffraction spots and then integrate all of them, and then from that you get the electron densities and then the full structure. So this is how this technique works, and then you have different steps here, but I'm not going into all those details. So we need to actually also understand the symmetry in the crystals. So we are just saying that they are arranged in repetitive fashion. Okay? So I can get this repetitive fashion in many ways, right? Suppose if I have another atom here and then one atom here, I can say that I am translating this atom, okay, in one direction. So this is actually translational symmetry. They are related by translational symmetry. Okay? Suppose if I have, if this is not a simple isotropic sphere, suppose if I have something like, if my molecule is something like that, and then if I see something like this here, so then I am translating as well as, I am also rotating, right? So, or if it is something like this, then I could be actually reflecting. Suppose if I have a mirror here, so then I will be reflecting. So this repetitiveness can come from some symmetry relationships. It's not that we are really doing this, but they have this relationship in the crystals. So we try to simplify so that we can just only consider the unit cell instead of considering the entire crystal. So this, we are trying to basically put all the information into this small unit cell box, and then we code it with these symmetry elements through which we can describe the entire matter. So that is what we are trying to do. So since time is short, I am going to run a little bit fast here. So we have basically translational symmetry and can be rotational symmetry, and then reflection or inversion. So suppose if you see the rotational symmetry, suppose if we have these objects, so then you do the 180 rotation, then you get the suppose if you do 180 rotation, so then you get this object, right? So there is a rotational symmetry here. So you can have so here when you do the rotation, you're not changing the handedness, right? Suppose if I have R configuration, when I do the rotation, I don't change the configuration, right? I take the R and then rotate it and then put the R in a different place. So we are also moving the entire molecule or whatever into a new position, right?